It has been haunting him for months. Kerry Fraser, the man with the best hair in hockey, will now be forced to wear a helmet.
How difficult has this been on you and your family?
It's been devastating. Look, I know it's for safety, but my hair is my identity. It's my mojo.
We're speaking with longtime NHL official Kerry Fraser. He's now an analyst for That's Hockey 2, as well as the blog host for Come On Ref blog. And he's also the author of The Final Call, which is a legendary book. So make sure you pick that up. Where can we get the book?
Well, the book is available at all of your retail outlets, certainly on Amazon.ca, Amazon.com. Any of your book stores can order it. It's published by McClellan and Stewart, which is now Random House, and it's became a bestseller very quickly once it hit the shelves.
You're talking about midget hockey. You've seen the footage of our local Chetwynd midget giants. Some of the hockey moms and hockey dads, obviously, were a little upset. Now, like I said, you've seen the footage. Can you just describe what you saw in those two sequences?
Well, hockey moms and hockey dads are really a tough crowd to appeal to, for sure. But I will tell you that it's often not fair for someone to pick one play or one call out of the context of a total game. But as I watched those plays, I was a little confused by the fact that on the first play, the player that was carrying the puck in the red jersey cut through and was tripped with a toe trip by the defending player. There was no call on that play. Then the player that had been tripped got up and was upset and retaliated with a very strong cross check. I'm surprised that that wasn't called, as you mentioned, but that something less significant was called that resulted in a delayed scoring of a goal. On the second play that I looked at, I saw that there was a little anxiousness on the part of the referee and an overreaction when the player that had fanned on his shot through a poke check by the defending player that was following the play, and then sort of incidental contact with the player's skate blade onto the defenseman's stick. I saw in the camera shot the referee raised his arm at that point, which I felt was rather a marginal call.
We were talking earlier about how some certain players upset you, and you could, as you are human, you held somewhat of a grudge. Is there such a thing as star player treatment? A lot of people are talking about it. One name that kept getting brought up on our Twitter account was Sidney Crosby, and a lot of people, I don't know if they're just Philadelphia fans or what have you, but they kept saying that he gets preferential treatment. How do you feel about this?
Well, Trevor, you'll read a great story in The Final Call in the Pittsburgh Penguin chapter, where I had some run-ins with Mario Lemieux early in our career, as I did with Sidney Crosby. The outcome of those were positive. However, they did things, in Sidney's case, certainly his early stages in the game, where he did a lot of complaining to the officials and whining. That didn't bode well with me. We had a confrontation in Toronto at the Air Canada Centre brought to a resolution how I felt Sidney should represent the game as the face of the game, and he's a tremendous player. So we worked it out and came to a positive resolution on the play. I think that star players often have the puck. The puck is around them. Gretzky certainly was the classic example of that. He controlled the play from behind the attacking net. So when the puck is in their vicinity, a lot of the time, there's foul potential on the player with the puck. And consequently, as good as those players are, to level the playing field, a defensive player will usually commit some infraction to either strip them of the puck or restrain them.
Speaking of that, this is sort of in the opposite realm, but Tony Gallagher of theprovince.com in Vancouver, and I'm sure you're familiar with Vancouver fans, they tend to think that the Vancouver Canucks are abused, and more abused than anyone in the NHL for that matter. But Tony Gallagher of theprovince.com wrote a story yesterday, and to paraphrase him, he said, "We speak of Alex Burrows standing in front of the net trying to do what lots of players in the league do at the time, screen the goalie. But with Burrows, there's a difference, and every defenseman in the league seems to know it. You see it. It's perfectly all right to cross-check him as hard as you like, perhaps punch him in the head or in the face. and there's virtually no chance the referee will give you a penalty. How do you feel about that statement, and do you have any issues with Alex Burrows, or do you have a story about Alex Burrows?
Well, the first question is, it sounds to me like Tony's playing the victim cycle a little too strongly. I think that, and I don't have a problem with Alex Burrows. As a matter of fact, what I did with Alex was go to him and say, hey, listen, I want you to play your game, but you need to be honest. And if I judge that you're not honest, you're going to pay the price. You're going to end up with a penalty. That's all I asked as a referee, that we're charged with upholding the integrity of the game in a lot of cases. And where players dive, act out, fake injury, I have no tolerance for that. And not just Alex Burrows. I think that the Vancouver Canucks have developed a reputation over time that the referees are a little disappointed in. And that's through some highly publicized incidents that occurred. You know, when Don Koharski and Jim Schoenfeld had their episode in the Stanley Cup playoffs, it took a while, according to Jim Schoenfeld, for the New Jersey Devils to overcome that reputation and that situation with the officials. I know I was certainly less tolerant following that when there was some noise off the Jersey Devils bench, and particularly from Coach Jim Schoenfeld. So as human beings, we have to try and overcome that tendency not to pay back, not to get even, but to rule on the incident itself. Bernie Nichols was playing for the New Jersey Devils in the Stanley Cup playoffs. They won the cup that year. And the game before I had, he had really lambasted my fellow referee in the newspapers publicly. During this game that I was refereeing, it was in the Meadowlands Arena, and the game was well in hand. The Devils were going to win it, and at the last stoppage, commercial stoppage, I went to Bernie, and he was standing in front of the photographer's area with no glass, and I said to him privately, I said, listen, Bernie, I'm really disappointed in you, in the fact that you had those negative statements to say. It's not the way to handle things, Bernie, and I'm really disappointed in you. He said, okay, I'm sorry, and that was it. Now, the media, some of the photographers overheard it, and they reported it to some of the scribes who asked Bernie about it in the dressing room postgame. What was it Kerry Fraser was asking you about? And Bernie, very professionally, said, what was said was between Kerry Fraser and I, and he was right.
One last question for the Canucks here. Mason Raymond's spin-o-rama, I know you've talked about it on TSN, but can you guide people through it as we show a highlight of the goal from the other night? How is the spin-o-rama legal in the shootout?
Well, the NHL Hockey Operations Department determined when this was first instituted on a shootout situation, they likened it to Dennis Savard, who perfected that move back in the 80s. It's a skilled play. It's not an easy thing to do by spinning around and maintaining possession and control of the puck. Under the virtue of the shootout or penalty shot rule, it says that the puck must be kept in motion toward the goal. Clearly, a spin-o-rama move constitutes continuous motion on the play. They like the skilled move, and they allow it. It's transcended into almost anything goes now on a shootout. We saw the other night with the point turned over on the stick blade and an attempt to spin around, jam it through the five hole on a shootout attempt. The lacrosse move is also allowed, where players can pick the puck up and whip it into the net as long as it's below the height of the crossbar. So I think we're seeing more of all-star game kind of technique used. The fans love it. Everybody goes, wow. And it is a skilled move that players are practicing. The problem is 1 point gained over a shootout win, as you accumulate those, can be the difference between a player or teams making the Stanley Cup playoffs or not.
I know I've kept you for longer than I was expecting, but can we just ask a couple more social media questions?
Sure.
Sure. Okay, this one comes from Tim Dickard. He asks, how did you avoid being influenced by a hometown crowd?
Well, you know, I think the personal makeup of an official, his integrity and his character, strength of character, is something that he carries forward within him into this profession. And it's really an integral part. When I started in the 70s and through the 80s, it was a very intimidating time within the game. We had the Broad Street Bullies, the Big Bad Bruins. There was brawling, bench clearings. And often cases, the intimidation factor that took place in the game was also part of what they did to the referees. Fans, players, hometown players would do their very best to intimidate the official. And you had to stand tall, you had to stand strong, or you'd be run out of the building. As a young player, my father was a minor professional player. He was a tough guy. He was a professional boxer. He taught me well. I played for him for 3 years of AAA midget. Seven of our players off our teams went on to play in the NHL. We were very good, won Ontario championships. And yet I was a little guy that played a lot bigger. I was the go-to guy that went out and fought the biggest guy on the other team. So courage was an important element of my character. I had to learn as I became a referee that I needed to be part of the solution and not part of the problem. I could not be intimidated, but I could not go out and try and incite players with an arrogant, cocky attitude either. So that's really important, Trevor, is that when the going gets tough and the tough get going, it's what you bring internally that will dictate how you respond to difficult situations.
We're speaking with the author of The Final Call, as well as an analyst on That's Hockey 2 and host of the blog Come On Ref. You can find him on Twitter at @KFraserTheCall. Sahil Sani asks on Facebook, which team or player was the whiniest you've ever had to deal with?
Well, you know, in the early stages, the great one and I had our confrontations. He would fall down easily in the Northlands Coliseum. I wrote about that situation in The Final Call as well. Bernie Federko, great player, Hockey Hall of Fame player, St. Louis Blue, longtime player, was a guy that always would get in my face. And we had back-to-back games one night. I had them in St. Louis, and he was upset with me, as he typically was, at the end of the game in St. Louis. And then we went to Chicago the next night, and I was refereeing that game as well between the Blues and the Hawks. And Bernie was the starting center, the opening faceoff. And as I was about to drop the puck, Bernie looked at me, cursed at me, and said, "Drop the blank puck." I said, "Bernie, we haven't even started the game yet, and already you're yelling at me." He said, "Just drop the bloody puck. Let's get going." And that's how we started that game. Bernie was quite a in-your-face kind of guy for me.
For fun interviews, I like to do a final three questions of the day. It's called Trevor's Daily Hat Trick, and I find it very fitting, being that you're an NHL ref. Can we do a quick hat trick here with you?
Shoot.
Okay, for the hat trick. Trevor, yours! Trevor has the hat trick.
All right, first question is geography question. You've been to the majority of arenas in North America. Who has the nicest arena, and who has the biggest dump?
Well, you know, now all the arenas are new and modern. The biggest dump was the auditorium in Buffalo. My gosh, it was just every time the puck was shot around the glass, it took crazy bounces. The Sabres, at the door that they exited and entered the ice, there was a big heavy guy that was their equipment manager. He weighed about 300 plus pounds. And when the puck was shot around, it was a patent play. The Sabres would dump the puck in around the boards, and the big guy would lean against the door and cause the bottom to pop open. The puck would hit and go right out in front of the net as the goalie had gone around behind to field what he thought was going to be a ring around. So that was the worst place to play or to officiate. I really enjoyed the old Chicago Stadium. Even though you walked in and it smelled down below of stale beer and it was an old building, the crowd and the energy in that building was like none you'd ever see. Modern day, we have certainly San Jose is a terrific crowd, as is Montreal. The new generation of fans in the Bell Center in Montreal are just energized every time, every game. They really bring it. So that's a terrific place to work.
You ref 261 playoff games. The most appearances in the NHL playoffs by a player was 266. You may have dined at his restaurant previously. Who is this man?
Well, that's got to be Wayne Gretzky and Gretzky's restaurant in Toronto, which I have dined in. And he was an amazing player. His statistics speak for themselves. But the one thing that people don't recognize Wayne for is what he brought to his team. He demanded that everybody around him be the very best they could be, and they all raised their game when Wayne put the evil eye on them.
What if I told you the answer was Chris Chelios?
No kidding. Well, that's good. Hey, you scored on me.
And finally, once you retired from the NHL in April of 2010, be honest with me, was your retirement gift a vat of conditioner?
Well, no, you know, I had a bunch of retirement gifts along the way, but the Paul Mitchell freeze and shine that I used throughout my career remains on my shelf today, and it takes me through hurricanes.
He is a man who's ref the most games in the NHL history. Currently, he's an analyst for That's Hockey, too. You can find him with the blog Come On Ref on tsn.ca. You can head to his Twitter, at KFraserTheCall. And a little known fact about him, Tina Turner actually wrote the song The Best about his hair. Kerry Fraser, thanks for joining me today.
Trevor, my pleasure, and the best to all my good friends in British Columbia.